Often, when I talk about search engines and how to build the information retrieval systems behind them, these ubiquitous portals to the internet, whether you're using Bing, Yahoo, Baidu, or Ask Jeeves, seem like a fundamental law of science. They've always been there. But it wasn't always like that. There was a time before search engines. And although there's a certain charm to card catalogs, they're neither an efficient nor a fun way to find information. My goal in this video is to tell the story of the Cranfield paradigm and how it made the 20th century internet possible. Much of this is drawn from the article The Evolution of Cranfield by Ellen Voorhees, which I encourage you to read, link in the description, if you want something with more detail, more references, and fewer errors. The story begins in 1967 with Cyril Cleverdon at Cranfield University in England, which pretty uniquely has an airport right on campus. Pretty cool. Here at the University of Maryland, we have to walk a whole 15 minutes to get to the oldest continuously operated airport in the world. Cyril Cleverdon was in charge of the library there, and he was big into computers, which were a new thing at the time. He wanted to see if he could measure how good an index was. Wait a second. When I say index, what do you think of? If you're over 35 and went to a public school, you might think of this sort of thing in the back of a book. But if you're younger or a computer scientist, you probably think of an index as a lookup table of every darn word possible in a document. And the reason that you think this way is because of the Cranfield experiment. Cyril Cleverdon's claim, which was quite controversial at the time, was that you could look up documents based on the words in the documents. You didn't need a laboriously created index. You could use a machine, or an engine, if you will, to search through them. The academic community at the time was skeptical. There's no way that these newfangled search engines could be better than a trained librarian armed with a trusty card catalog. Before we analyze this, I want to do a quick refresher of how a search engine query is evaluated. Again, this is old hat now, but it was revolutionary at the time. To evaluate a system's ability to search a data set, you take some queries from users, and then somehow you find all of the truly relevant documents to the query in all of your collection. Out of all of the documents they returned in red here, how many were right? And recall, out of all of the possible right documents, how many did they find? So in this case, the precision is one document out of three was relevant out of all the things in red, and the recall is one out of two. You got half of the relevant documents. At the risk of sounding like a broken record, I want to emphasize just how revolutionary this was. Once you found the relevant documents, you could evaluate any system. Before, you had to run an expensive user experiment every time you tweaked your systems. Did that output look good? How about this one? Let me change something. How about this? With a reusable test collection, you could turn the crank on your retrieval system without pesky humans getting in the way and slowing things down. Just check whether the red box finds the relevant documents or not. But not everybody was convinced. The Cranfield paradigm is making a lot of assumptions here. A document is relevant, it's as equally relevant as every other document that's been marked as relevant. Showing you my explanation of topic modeling is as good as a video from Siraj Raval. The second assumption is that users' information needs are static. If you ask the question, who is the president of the United States in the late 60s, it'll never change. The answer is still Richard Nixon, even in the year 3000. The next assumption is that all users are the same. When I ask the question, why is the sky blue, I should get the same answer as my 6-year-old daughter. Finally, the Cranfield paradigm assumes that somebody, somehow, can find all of the right answers from thousands or millions of documents. Despite these obviously wrong assumptions that Ellen Voorhees details here in the paper that I link down below, the assumptions on average mostly hold, or at least they cancel out. That's why we're still talking about the Cranfield paradigm 50 years later. And there were some big additions to the Cranfield paradigm. Most prominent was the use of better document representations and creating larger test collections, which was spearheaded by Karen Spark, just a little bit west of Cranfield at Cambridge University. These took the theoretical insights of the original Cranfield experiments and made them into something that people could actually use. And they worked! Again, this was revolutionary. As a result, the British Computing Society named their annual award for researchers in this area after Karen Spark Jones. But for the Cranfield paradigm to really shape the answers that we get from the internet and to build the world mega search engines that we have today, we need to leave central England and meet a new player, NIST, the American National Institute for Standards and Technology. While the story of the birth of the Cranfield paradigm is an innovative insight with Cyril Cleverden combined with the vision of Karen Spark Jones, the story of NIST development of these test collections is one of slow, steady methodological iteration, building up decades of expertise and slowly building up bigger and bigger test collections, updating them each year with more diverse data and better evaluation techniques so that by the time Google's PageRank came around, there's no question about how to tell whether a search engine is good enough. Just fire up the latest test collection from the Trek conference, compute your precision and recall, and call it a day. And this approach toward evaluation is with us in everything that we do now in artificial intelligence, machine learning, and natural language processing. Test collections are how we evaluate virtual assistants, question answering systems, and just about every aspect of the modern internet. And it's not always for the best. The ubiquity of these reusable test collections leads to overfitting. Trek puts out new data sets every year or so, but that's not fast enough for machine learning in the 21st century on archive. And while the focus on real user data is good, the data you collect is biased by who's using the technology. Mostly rich people from Western countries who can afford a smartphone. And those users have been trained to ask questions through decades of living with Cranfield paradigm systems. They don't ask impossible questions they know that Google won't give them an answer to. And unlike people who work on, say, human-computer interaction, those building QA systems often don't actually put their system in front of real users. And I don't think that's what Cyril Cleverden would have wanted. His goal as a librarian was to help users. And yes, reusable test collections help you do that. And they've spawned multi-billion dollar companies around the world. But at the end of the day, you still need to check whether real users are actually finding the information that they need. This is just a single lecture from a course. YouTube likes to show you these videos out of order, but if you go to the course webpage linked below, you can see the lectures in the right order, and you can get resources like homeworks or suggested reading. You can also visit quanta.org if you want to learn about our systems for creating computers that can answer questions, where Quanta stands for question answering is not a trivial activity. If you want to help the channel, provide a big gradient to the algorithm by liking and subscribing.